Hi, let's talk about the nerves of the posterior neck. So with respect to the nerves in this area, there are a few recurring themes that we're going to revisit continually throughout this course. One of the major themes that we'll repeat is that of the vagus nerve or cranial nerve 10. The vagus nerve exits from the jugular foramen. It is bound up with the internal carotid and the internal jugular vein by condensations of deep cervical fascia called the carotid sheath. So within the carotid sheath, we are able to see a couple of major elements, and they're pulled apart here. So here we have the internal carotid artery, there's the external carotid, and they meet the common carotid. And here we have the internal jugular vein, and descending down here is the vagus nerve, or cranial nerve 10. Let's erase all of these. Keep in mind that these elements have been pulled apart for the sake of being able to see the deeper elements. So normally the common carotid and the internal jugular are approximate to one another, and then the vagus is sort of intermediate and posterior to these two elements. So let's talk a little bit about the vagus nerve and some of the branches that we'll see from the vagus. So this right here is the lower edge of the parotid gland. And if we were to look deep and beyond there, we can see the bulk of the vagus nerve traveling down. And this would be within the carotid sheath. And before it descends too far, we see this bifurcation there. That bifurcation is the superior laryngeal nerve. And so the superior laryngeal nerve, as its name would suggest, serves the larynx. There are two branches to it, and we can see there's one branch that's heading this way. This is a little bit larger on this particular donor. It continues there, and it then pairs up with an artery branch, and this would be the superior laryngeal artery. And the two dive through a little hiatus in the thyrohyoid membrane, which is located between the hyoid bone and the thyroid cartilage here. And they serve the deeper parts of the larynx. So that would be the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. And that internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is going to serve the mucosa superior to the vocal folds. And we'll learn more about the vocal folds when we discuss the larynx. This particular nerve is afferent and secretomotor to that mucosa superior to the vocal folds. The other branch, which we can see here, is a little smaller on this specimen, or more delicate, and it's coming down there. It's running behind the bifurcation of the common carotid, and it's picked up there and continues on down, where it innervates the cricothyroid muscle. So that's the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, which is efferent or motor to the cricothyroid. Whenever I have to quickly think about which is which, you know, I think about myself, and you know, I like to think that I'm muscular on the outside or the external, and sensitive or sensory on the inside or the internal. So let's follow the path of the vagus as it continues to move down through the carotid sheath. It's going to send a branch to the pharyngeal plexus, and we'll discuss that when we talk about the pharynx. But eventually, the vagus is going to enter into the thorax as it passes through the root of the neck. And when it does so, the vagus is going to send another branch to the larynx called the recurrent laryngeal nerve. That recurrent laryngeal nerve is different on the right versus the left side. So we'll look at both now. So here is the right common carotid artery. There is the right internal jugular vein. And kind of between them here, we can see the vagus nerve meandering down through. And we know that we're in the root of the neck because we see the right subclavian artery there. We would see the right subclavian vein continue there. So between the two, down comes the vagus nerve. And that vagus nerve is transmitted through the thorax. Eventually, it's going to end up in the abdominal cavity. But right past the root of the neck, the right vagus nerve sends the right recurrent laryngeal nerve looping around the right subclavian artery. So that's really high in the root of the neck. That's going to continue on, and it's going right for the tracheoesophageal groove. So there's a groove between the trachea, which is anterior, and the esophagus, which is posterior. And it's right in the side there, and it travels up toward the larynx. On the left side, here's the left common carotid artery. There's the left internal jugular vein. And here's the left vagus nerve coming down. As you can see, it shoots through the root of the neck. It's continuing on down. Wow, it's going really far. And then it sends the left recurrent laryngeal nerve wrapping around the concavity of the arch of the aorta. And that, like its counterpart on the right, is heading straight for the tracheoesophageal groove. And then it finds that groove and ascends in that groove up to the larynx. The recurrent laryngeal nerves are sometimes referred to as the inferior laryngeal nerves whenever they cross the plane of the cricoid cartilage, which is approximately there. So that cricoid cartilage, as we'll learn in the session of the larynx, is a ring of cartilage that forms the base of the larynx. And when these nerves pass that plane, some sources will refer to the recurrent laryngeal nerve as the inferior laryngeal nerve. Whatever you call it, you know, a rose is a rose is a rose. The recurrent or the inferior laryngeal nerve, these are efferent to all of the other intrinsic laryngeal muscles. So all of the intrinsic laryngeal muscles, with the exception of cricothyroid, are supplied by their innervation by the recurrent laryngeal. And they're also afferent and secrete a motor to the mucosa inferior or distal to the vocal folds. The vagus nerves are going to have a large role in the thorax. They're going to supply the parasympathetic input to the cardiac plexus, the cardiac autonomic plexus, the respiratory or pulmonary plexuses there. They supply the esophageal plexus, and then they're going to be parasympathetic to the gut tube and organs of the gastrointestinal system in the abdominal pelvic cavity, as we'll see. Let's take a look again back at the neck, and here we're going to see the accessory nerve. It will be highly variable. I'm going to just kind of trace over it here. The accessory nerve usually has a slight sort of telephone cord like bend to it. And now that I've outlined it there, I'm going to erase that so that you can more clearly see it. And then I'll just circle that there. The accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, is an interesting cranial nerve. It's a predominantly efferent, or motor, mainly motor nerve, as we say. It arises from the cervical spine as rootlets, and then those rootlets coalesce into the nerve. And that nerve enters the skull via the foramen magnum, and then it travels up and leaves through the jugular foramen with the glossopharyngeal and vagus nerves. So cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11 all exit through the jugular foramen. And we can't see the jugular foramen here on this particular skull, but it would be deep to this area here. We can see a very distended IJ heading up in that particular direction. And so the accessory nerve is efferent, or motor, to the sternocleidomastoid and trapezius muscles. We say mainly motor. There may be some afferent fibers contained within the accessory nerves. Some sources do discuss this, but predominantly the afferents to SCM and trapezius muscles are branches from the ventral primary rami of cervical nerves 2, 3, and 4, as we've discussed. The spinal nerves, as they exit from the spinal cord, are going to exit as ventral and dorsal primary rami. Now, if I were to just draw a spinal nerve here, so this would be the root of that spinal nerve. There's the dorsal. I'm sorry, that would be the trunk of the spinal nerve. There's the dorsal root, and then that dorsal root ganglion, and then those dorsal rootlets. There's the ventral root and the ventral rootlets. So afferent comes in through the dorsal, efferent goes out through the ventral. And so this trunk here is mixed, and then we have a dorsal primary ramus and a ventral primary ramus. So wherever you see VPR, that's ventral primary ramus. It's typically these ventral primary rami which come together in certain areas to form plexuses. A plexus is a group of rami that coalesce together and then form various nerves. And the advantage here is that different spinal nerve levels are able to contribute to different nerves. So when we talk about the cervical plexus, we're talking about the ventral primary rami of cervical nerves C1, C2, C3, and C4. One of the nerves that arises from the cervical plexus is the phrenic nerve. And we can see the phrenic nerve descending down here. That would be this lovely. And it enjoys a very special relationship with the anterior scalene muscle, which has been reflected away. And that is that the phrenic nerve runs just anterior and upon the anterior scalene muscle. So then the phrenic nerve is running between the subclavian artery and what would be the subclavian vein at the root of the neck. And it continues on down to innervate the diaphragm. The phrenic nerve has its roots from C3, 4, and 5. So you'll notice that C5 sometimes will contribute to the cervical plexus, but it's more a component of the next plexus that we'll discuss, the brachial plexus. So that phrenic nerve, sometimes you'll hear the mnemonic C345 keeps the diaphragm alive, because that's what innervates the diaphragm. So moving more inferiorly now, or distally down the spinal cord, we have the brachial plexus. The brachial plexus consists of ventral primary rami from C5 through T1. And while I'm not a dancer, I always remember this as the brachial plexus is C5, 6, 7, 8, T1. Now, these are what are known as the roots of the brachial plexus. The roots of any plexus are ventral primary rami. Students get confused all of the time because in the sense of the spinal cord, if you recall, with dorsal and ventral roots, these come together to form a trunk, and then there's a dorsal ramus and a ventral ramus. So these here are the roots of a spinal nerve. These here are the rami of the spinal nerve. But in the context of a plexus, it's these rami, and in particular with the cervical and brachial plexus, it's the ventral primary rami, which are the roots of these plexuses. So don't get that confused. The brachial plexus is going to innervate both afferently and efferently the upper limb, inclusive of the shoulder. So we can see very well here. So this is C5. C6, C7, C8, and T1. These roots coalesce, so C5 and C6 come together to form the superior trunk. C7 continues without coalescing to form the middle trunk. And then C8 and T1 coalesce to form the inferior trunk. These trunks are then going to form divisions. These divisions will form cords. And from roots, trunks, divisions, and cords, we have branches. The branches are the individual nerves that come out of the brachial plexus. And there's a mnemonic for everything in anatomy. And that mnemonic for the brachial plexus that you hear quite a bit is Randy Travis drinks cold beer. Roots, trunks, divisions, cords, and branches. So we've discussed two cranial nerves, the vagus, cranial nerve 10, and the accessory, cranial nerve 11, the cervical plexus and one of its motor branches, the phrenic, the brachial plexus and its structure. Thank you for your time.